buying them, right? So I wanted to buy an iPhone, and whenever I would open Flipkart, I would see a different price on the site. And the prices would fluctuate from, you know, 40,000 rupees to 50,000 rupees. That was the huge price difference I would often find, right? So I eventually bought the phone after tracking it manually, but then I decided ever again I am buying a product, I do not really want to do this manually, right? So let me automate it for myself at least. So, and hence I basically wrote a very tiny script over a weekend which would accept a product URL and send me emails if the prices fall or rise or whatever. And I basically posted that tiny script over Twitter. And people were like, yeah, why don't you, you know, also let me send this email to myself. Give me a field to enter my email ID. I was like, cool. So, and hence basically a tiny page came up, which was about, you paste a product URL and your email ID, and you receive price drop alerts as and when they happen. So that is the origin of why CheapAss came up and what led to it. So my name is Akash Goyal, and we'll be sharing everything about what I learned while building CheapAss, all the learnings I had, both in terms of technology, building a product by yourself, right, taking it to market, marketing, whatnot. So, yeah. So I maintained CheapAss for about 3.5 years, and it's now shut down as a product, but is available as a open source, do it yourself, host yourself technology, right? So anybody can basically clone a couple of repositories and have CheapAss running for themselves. Right, so in its very simple form, as I said, it's a price drop alert service, right, which would accept a product URL, email ID, and send you price drop alerts. This was launched back in June 2014, and since then I've sort of owned the entire suite of building the product, right, from, you know, sales and support to product management, prioritizing features, what to build, what not to build, talking to customers, getting feedback, right, and being basically tech support as well if something goes down middle of the night. So just to give you a brief idea about the numbers as to the scale at which CheapAss was operating before it shut down. So it served about 7,500 active users at its peak, who tracked cumulatively about 40,000 products, and system sent up more than 6.5 lakh price drop alerts, right? And it helped people save more than 15 lakh rupees, right? So yeah, that's the kind of tiny scale it served. And the product kind of made money for itself. It was self-sustaining. Product would make money from affiliate commissions, and that's the money I would pump back into, you know, running the service. So here's a tiny earnings report from Amazon. They pay you something between 4.5% to 10% for all the sales that happen through you. Right, so the product made it to Product Hunt. It was on Hacker News for a bit, on React Rocks, and a bunch of other, you know, publications which said that CheapAss is the number one price tracking service for the Indian e-commerce site scene. Right, Akshay Pathak, I'm sure a lot of bunch of folks know him on Twitter. So this guy tweeted about, you know, CheapAss, and this guy has about 1 million followers right now. And when this guy tweeted, basically it led to a lot of organic traffic, which, you know, all his followers started knowing about CheapAss. And a bunch of other folks, right? And they kept saying a lot of good things about CheapAss. Due to which in the initial early days, I never really had to market this, you know, by spending money on it. So this colleague of mine, he was very happy buying cheap chatties of CheapAss. So yeah, getting to the core of the talk, right? So the learnings while I had while, you know, building the service, and then we will go to learnings I had while, you know, taking this product to the market and the product side of it, right? So getting to the core of the talk, this is slightly about, you know, how backends work. So folks in the house who have worked on Node.js, they would be aware that, you know, you can, there are two ways of requiring modules, right? You can basically do a static require or a dynamic require, right? So what I mean by dynamic require is, you know, loading a module at a function execution time. So you can basically, you know, do something like this. You have a function and you require things as modules within that function, right? And as opposed to static loading, which is about loading a module at node process startup. So at the top of the file, you basically say require this particular component, right? So how many of you think this code would scale? Like, what would happen if I call this function in a loop? Would something go wrong? What would go wrong because of that? Will this code scale? All right, so here's what happened. So this is a funny incident how I discovered this. So as you see, the function name is called send email. And I was using this to send mass emails to all my customers when I would launch a new feature or any information I want to share with them, right? So up until the number of users was less than 1,024, this code just worked perfectly, right? But when the number of users went 1,025, this code basically started throwing errors, right? And it stopped working. And then I discovered that, you know, the default number of open files on a Unix machine can be 1024, right? So a dynamic require, what it basically does is it opens a file in real time in memory. Right? And a Linux system basically puts a limit to the number of simultaneously openable files, right? So this code basically stopped working because of that. This is a fun learning I had while, you know, in a small project, you would never really think about whether should I put a require in the function or at the top. But it's a tiny little learning which I had while, you know, when you call this function at scale. So all I really had to do was, you know, cut this file from a dynamic, make it static, and it just worked perfectly. So dynamic require is a terrible idea at scale unless you know really exactly what and how the function will be called, right? So that's one. Processing data, you know, stored in database. So we often deal with bunch of, I mean, large set of data sets, and you know, we are often supposed to derive useful numbers out of them. So here is a sample instance of that. So this used to be one of the sections on CPaaS homepage, where I would basically show in a sorted order the most popular products on CPaaS, the best prices you can probably get them at, right? How many people are tracking it? That was one of the major factors of promoting it at the top. So which basically involved looking up at multiple tables, joining them and whatnot, right? I was using MongoDB, so joins even don't exist, right? So you are basically left with a few choices. You can either, you know, kind of talk to multiple tables and, you know, grab all the data in, you know, using a find command, and then process on each item some further query, right? And as the number of products in the system grew, this piece of code just kept growing slower, right? Because when the number of products were probably 50, 100, this code would take about 30 seconds, 45 seconds to probably process. And I would cache this for later usage, right? And probably run a cron job over it to process it over and over again. But yeah, this code basically stopped scaling up with time as the number of products grew up, right? So what I learned was find basically was copying all results in memory, right? So as you can see, I was doing a seller.find, I was grabbing all the active products and then some more features and find ones, right? And then I spoke to a few folks at office who were into backend dealing with databases as to what could be the best way of, you know, dealing with databases. And hence, I was made aware of this tiny utility called aggregate, right? So what that basically meant was stop pulling in data in memory to process. You know, process as much as you can at the DB layer, at an abstraction layer, and then pull it out to your node process, right? And when I did that, it was computing only, you know, copying only computed results onto the node process. And that basically took down the time, which was about 4 minutes. And this is back in 2015, right? And service was launched in June 2014, not even an year. And it was taking 4 minutes to process. And just doing that, the timing went down to about 8 seconds. So yeah, pulling data in memory to process is not such a great idea at scale, right? So you have to be careful of what amount of data set you will be dealing with. Spawning with care, right? So in most of the backend systems, we come across with some task which has to deal with, you know, so let's say you want to print a PDF out of some ticket, right? Or anything which requires you to spin up a new process, which will talk to the parent process via some inter-process communication, right? And I was doing the same. So at CPaaS, I used to basically crawl a page, take a screenshot out of a real deal that's probably happening, and send that in an email or somewhere, right? So I was using a tool called Capture.js, which was nothing but a wrapper over Phantom.js. And this guy would again spin up a new process, and these two processes will, you know, talk to each other via some inter-process communication. So here's a script that used to do that. So I used to say Capture.js of this URI, and I used to pass in a selector. Right, and these third-party services, they change their pages every single day, right? They don't bother about whether the third-party system is dependent on that or not, right? And so, yeah, I mean, it was all fine until one day all hell broke loose, right? My machine was full of Phantom.js processes, and I had no idea why that's happening, right? So, and then I realized, you know, this particular selector that I was passing to Capture.js was not present on the page anymore. Right, due to which, whatever communication was happening between Node.js and Phantom.js, that basically broke, right? Due to which, my node process was spinning up thousands of processes because I thought, okay, I haven't got the communication back, let me try again, right? I could have probably handled that, but of course, I mean, you don't handle errors until you discover them, right? So Yeah, so that's something that happened. So spawning processes on server is a tricky business because you have to be very careful as to how much and how often you should clean up or keep a tab at a rogue process that might destroy your entire memory. The next point is about never relying on systems you didn't build, which again piggybacks on the last point we discussed. Cheepass used to talk to proxy services. It was dependent on Flipkart to be open, to be working, Amazon to be up and running, Snapdeal to be up and running, and whatnot, right? So plenty of third-party developers the site was reliant on. So, and not just that, I mean, even if you're making a regular, request to a server, there are a bunch of things that the server will take care of, like an Amazon will deal it differently than a Flipkart, right? So, let's talk about cookies, let's say. So what happens is when you make a server-to-server call, request clients do not send cookies by default, right? And that's something which the guy who is getting the request can track, that this request does not seem to be coming from browser. So definitely it's a bot or not a user, right? So, but however, what happens is in the next request, in the subsequent request, this guy will send back, a cookie back, right? So if somebody is blocking you because they say that, you aren't sending a cookie, so you are a bot, well, you can consume that first response back, use that cookie and send it back, and make yourself behave like a real browser. So this is something that's called a cookie jar and can help circumvent issues if somebody's blocking you because they feel you're not sending cookies to them. Then again, if you are making, concurrent cron jobs at, 3 p.m., 6 p.m., 9 p.m., 12 p.m., then any good sane developer will be able to figure you out that, if you're machine trying to figure out something from their servers, right? So patterns while making requests to a third-party server is never a good practice, right? So, then they present you with bot captures and they flag your IP as something, a bad IP, right? So as a tiny developer, I was forced to do nothing but buy proxies, pay for proxy services, right? So I spent thousands of dollars in proxy services to keep Cheepass up and running, to make it reliant. Right, so you have to basically rotate IPs, proxies, user agents to keep fooling the other third-party service as if you are a new browser or a new user. Another interesting thing that happens is something called as a honeypot. So when a crawler is crawling a page, it will basically find all a href equal to tags and try to hit them, right? And what these services will do to detect these bots is to add hidden anchor tags, right? Which a user will never see, so never click. But a bot doesn't know about it, so he will click that, right? So that's called a honeypot. So a crawler is attracted to clicking that, and you have to avoid that while you crawl. Right, so IP rotation isn't really cheap, but the only solution if you're managing your own servers, right? So literally thousands of dollars paid in paid proxies to crawl these third-party services. And as the site's name goes, Cheepass, so I thought to myself, how can I be the Cheepass? Why am I spending so much money in crawling and keeping the service up? How can I reduce my recurring costs to absolutely nil or very minuscule, right? And yet keep making those revenues. I thought to myself, I will not maintain my own servers, right? Let's deep dive into this world of serverless technologies and let's see what this is all about. And this is the time when I was shutting down Cheepass, right? And I wanted to keep the service up for myself at least, if not nobody else. So serverless is nothing but, I'm sure you guys are aware, it's not your servers, but somebody else's servers, right? So of course things can go wrong over there as well. So let's redo the whole problem, right? Let's say that we want to build Cheepass again right from scratch, and we do not want to incur any recurring costs in doing that, right? So here are the main ingredients to that solution, right? So you have a couple of Lambda functions, right? So Lambda functions are not really machines, but functions which you can invoke that are not your headache, right? So you are given an IP, an endpoint which you can hit, and that function will run, right? So I thought to myself that the core logic of my application will live, let's say, in a Lambda function, and I'll get to why there are two Lambda functions. And I would need a database to store what people are tracking, right? So instead of maintaining my own database, I chose to go ahead with some key value pair, right? Let's say DynamoDB or a Firestore, any of those kind of services, right? And I needed one web server to be able to accept users' requests, right? Incoming requests, what people want to track, right? So now, these are some very generic set of problems, and there are plenty of people solving it. But I chose to go ahead with these guys because they always had a free tier to play with, right? So AWS Lambda has a big enough, very generous free tier. Google Cloud Firestore is a very generous free tier again, and Zeek now is one of the best. You know, all the products from Zeek are pretty kick-ass in their own way. So let's discuss the architecture as to how this works, how serverless versus, you know, maintaining your own servers works, right? So let's say there is a user, and as a user, my problem statement is that I want to track this product for price drops, right? So what do? I probably go to a website, or I have a Chrome extension which makes an API call to some remote server, right? That this is the product I want to track. This is my email ID, please track it for me, right? So we have a Zeek node server. It's a nodes process running on Zeek Cloud. And this guy basically talks to Google Firestore. Pretty simple user journey, right? I want to track something. I talk to a node server which stores in the Google Firestore database. Now let's say there is one Lambda function which is only responsible for, given an input of a URL, he should be able to open up a browser, process the whole HTML, and respond back with it, right? So a very simple HTTP service accepts a URL, responds back with the scraped HTML, right? Then there is another you know, Lambda process which deals with running concurrent jobs. So this guy is basically responsible for you know, scraping the prices frequently, and a bunch of other tasks like parsing the HTML to grab meaningful data out of it, and communicating with our primary Node.js server. Right, so the task is to, let's say that at every 15 minutes, talk to my database, grab all the products, and you know, spin up browsers to grab the prices. However, due to certain limitations, you can't set that up on the Lambda server itself. Lambda does not allow you to push binaries of Google Firestore or anything on their own servers. So what I did was I basically made Lambda talk to Zeek Now server. So every 15 minutes, Lambda would ping Node server, you know, boss, it's time to crawl everything, right? And this guy would basically grab all the products and in parallel invoke n number of Lambda functions, right? Now this is the extreme power of Lambda functions, because when I was maintaining my own servers, my own browsers on server, I had limit of memory because it was one machine, right? So at max, I could probably run two or three different browser instances. But now since each browser is running in its own Lambda, I do not need to worry about scale, right? So per URL, I was invoking you know, n number of Lambda functions. And this is where the power of serverless really shows through, right? So n number of URLs, invoking n number of browsers, each browser returning back with raw HTML, which parses JSON, stores it in the node server, which stores in the Cloud Firestore, right? And now the node server basically takes care of figuring out what is the last price, if the last price is less than or more than the current price, whatever logic to basically, you know, shoot price drop notifications, right? So, and this guy would also send push notifications, SMSs, emails, whatnot, right? So one place to manage core communication. So this is, you know, scraping at scale done right, and which can scale up to, you know, millions of concurrent requests out of the box, right? No additional code required, no maintaining running browser instances, because these browsers are very, you know, they were spun up in real time, right? It's as good as a headless browser. So anything could go wrong while trying to, you know, scrape that page, out of memory issues, whatnot. However, when in your own box, you have a limited memory, and it's dedicated to that server, to the browser, right? So it always works. You get automated IPs out of the box. No need to pay for proxies because AWS Lambda invokes its own machine, right? So it's a unique IP out of the box. And all third-party functions work or fail in their own box, right? So one URL not working due to any reason does not impact the rest of the site going down. Right, so I moved away from a self-hosted nightmare JS Puppeteer sort of a solution to, you know, Chromeless on Lambda, which scaled really well. I moved away from self-hosted MongoDB to, you know, Google Cloud Firestore. It scaled pretty well. Moved away from paid proxies to, you know, AWS Lambda, free proxies, free IPs, right? And no maintaining your own load balancers or servers, move to Zeek Now. Like all open source, free to use technologies that, you know, if you're planning to build something, there is no reason that, you know, I'm not a DevOps guy, so I can't build this. Right, the free ways of getting everything up and running. Right, so all this code is, you know, pretty much open source. You can look at it, set it up for yourself, see how it works. Right, the next point about building product is, you know, think scale in terms of how would you like to present your clients with the best of consumable APIs or clients, right? So I built CPaaS only for the web, but then it scaled pretty soon to a bookmarklet, to a Chrome extension, to an iOS app, to an Android app, to a Twitter bot, and whatnot, right? So one basically endpoint that could be consumed by any client, right? So you as a guy, as a backend, wearing a backend hat, you once wrote an API that could basically accept an incoming request from anywhere, and that basically helped me create several of these clients doing different things, right? There was one time effort of basically building an iOS app. I had to design it, I had to build the React Native components for it, right? But he chose something that could scale. So knowing that React Native's code is pretty much reusable, right, in terms of the core components. When it comes to, you know, the native OS level components, of course you have to use the OS specific components, right? So design was 100% reuse. Android components basically were created by 80% reuse, right? So here's a comparison of how iOS and Android look, right? So very simple difference of the how iOS behaves at the nav level versus how Android behaves at the nav level, right? The rest everything was basically very consumed as it is. There was a bot which basically had more followers than me at certain time, right? And all this guy did was basically shoot alerts as and when they happened on a feed, right? And this was a massive spam. Look at it, like 1 lakh tweets sent in no amount of time, right? Because that's the speed at which you get priced up alerts, right? And yet 232 people used to follow this this spam, right? So however, this led to back engagement, right? This was all searchable on Google. So Google used to think, okay, new content is being created for CPaaS. So it always led to more organic, better ratings, right? So for instance, CPaaS was always the number one in search listing if you search for price drops in India or price drop alerts, anything, right? Nobody could take it down. So that was the learnings out of building the product technically. We'll move to the learnings while, you know, growing the user base, right? So back in the days when the service was being used by nobody, I basically made it for friends and family, right? The itch was there to make it big, right? How do I make more people know about this? So back in the days, like very early days, I started coming up with, you know, things like spamming my users, which was, so I hate spam, to be honest, right? I don't like random emails coming to my inbox. But these were emails that were having a good open rate because they were dealing with something useful, right? So a user had subscribed to a price drop alert and he was happy to open a price drop alert email. And those emails were having good open rates. So I was like, why not push some more, you know, inside those emails? Why just two numbers, right? So what I started doing was I captured live deals from Amazon, Flipkart, etc. in real time, right before sending the price drop alert email, right? So this is how the email would look. You know, it would show the old price, new price, and, you know, a deal picked from Amazon in real time. And it clearly says that ends in 19 hours. That's Amazon's UI, right? I was just taking a screenshot, uploading it on S3, pulling the UI URL back, injecting it in the email, right? And right after this, it like even shot up the open rate of these emails, because earlier people were reluctant, maybe I'll not find the best price, but now they were coming to new deals as well, something they might be interested in. Right, so back in 2015, when the number of emails weren't even a lot, it had a 40% open rate, which was not really bad for this kind of service, because I was sending too many emails per day anyways. Right, and tiny incentives really go a long way in India. I mean, you might think that if somebody gives you 10 rupees, you will not take it, but people do. Right, so I basically doled out free recharge coupons to people if they rage about CPaaS on social media, and they actually did. So whenever somebody will buy from CPaaS, they made it a point to send me a personal email and post it on Facebook, whatever they have bought, right? And you know, for nothing but some 20-25 rupees of coupons, right? And coming to the end of the discussion, I mean, there is no perfect product, right? So I started building this for myself with just me as a user, right? Never really thought scale. And I think before shutting it down, it was running on probably Node 0.10. Some really old libraries, really outdated libraries. You know, it's okay to not build everything you can in the first cut, right? We often hesitate not to release something because we think, no, let's build more on top of it, let's make it more perfect, right? And then we'll release it. You know, it's always great to get user feedback and then work on top of it, because what you're envisioning as a product might not even be used another day. So might as well just release something and get users' feedback before you. Right, so the product evolved for about 3 years before shutting down. The iOS Android apps were basic read-only apps to begin with. It was only when the user said that I would like to, you know, be able to add a product from my Android app did I add that feature. Right. So just build something and ship. I mean, if you're working on a side project, it's never a perfect time to ship it. It's like it's always there. Right. Just build something and ship it. And yeah, let's end with that. Thank you. Any questions, any feedbacks, Doug?
I'm audible, right?
Yes.
Okay, so how many front-end developers do we have here? I'm doing a head count, okay, quick. Fine, so most of the people that have signed up for this event are front-end developers, good, great. So I'm not going to bore you with a lot of code or things that you should do and you should not do, but let's have a quick overview, because JavaScript gives you a lot of power to do things that other platforms cannot. So I'm watching for JavaScript here, but there are bad things and bad sides to it as well. So let's have a look at it. So this is a quick intro about me. I'm Gautam. Currently I'm working at Rapido as a front-end engineer. I started my career as a front-end developer, or say a Java developer, for Hong Kong and Shanghai Banking Corporation. And it's an entirely different scenario when you work for a bank and you develop sites. So first day at my job, I was like, okay, shit, I can see 400 people working together to make a single website run. That's ridiculous, right? And then I realized it was not 400, it was 4,000 people working on a single website. So apart from the front-end logic and the JavaScript, there's a lot that should go into the code. So I'm going to, let's start with it. So like I said, JavaScript gives us a lot of power, and there are both like good and bad sides to it. As front-end engineers, we tend to over-engineer stuff, okay? Like, for example, I'm working on a particular product, and then all of a sudden a random requirement flies in from the product department, and we have to deliver it in a short period of time. We know, okay, I'm good with JavaScript, I'm good with jQuery, I'll hack my way through. It's pretty easy to deliver. But that's bad, right? So we take JavaScript for granted. Okay, am I building my site for everyone? That's the thing that most of us consider, that, okay, I am building it for everyone. But do we consider all the kind of users that can hop onto our site and the things that they can do? The top question is, how much time do we spend on designing the website, the architecture of it, rather than jumping onto coding stuff? You know, we all can code, we all can write good HTML code, we all are fairly good with CSS, and JavaScript gives us a lot of power. So we all can code, but how much time that you spend on designing the entire application is what matters. And we realize it most when you have to debug into production deployments, and those things. When you're in a rota for a bank, I'm sharing a personal experience of mine. You have to spend 3 days completely, 72 hours debugging into code till the rota ends, or till some other person takes it up. Okay, so let's move on. Have I built it to scale? That's the first question. Second one, how do I manage my keys and service URLs? Are they configurable on the fly? Now, this is a very, very important thing to do, because okay, how many of you check in your keys and URLs into GitHub, into your repositories? Like, be honest about it. Most of us do at some point of time. We have done it, and we know the consequences, right? The third point is, like, how much of my code is reusable? Are we actually planning through all the like components that are required to set up a particular website or application? Are we looking into the reusability factor whether this particular component of mine, although we cannot open source everything, how can it be reused within the same organization? That is one thing for sure, right? And then, is my code readable to the people who are sitting right next to me? That's one more thing that we should consider. Now, these are very like fairly simple points. Now let's come down to the last one. Can you read it properly? So that's an accessibility issue in itself. Have I taken care of accessibility? Now accessibility is a thing that is mostly overlooked by people working in not so big organizations. But organizations that scale up, they can be fined huge amounts of money if their website is not accessible. This is a huge concern. And Disney, Netflix, HSBC, Barclays, they have been fined billions of dollars for that. Now they can compensate for that. But consider a small business which is in the growth stage. If you push something and then you see a tweet coming up saying, okay, I have color blindness for a particular color, and the content on the website is not at all visible. So that can end you up in a lawsuit, a typical lawsuit for people who are partially impaired. Okay, so before we jump on to talk more about accessibility, let's talk about some basic things that we should look forward to. Embrace progressive enhancement. Do you always trust that your customers will have JavaScript allowed on their browsers? Okay, now when we are working in startups and all, we actually do not think of this as much of an issue. But when we work for banks or we work for e-commerce websites, then we do consider that there will be a set of people in some remote city of India that will try to access your website through an old PC from a cyber cafe. Now those PCs have numerous blockers running on them. They cannot even download the entire JavaScript code that you have put up. So even if nothing works, we should design our websites in such a way that even if your JavaScript code is not allowed to execute, it should feel gracefully. You should always greet the user. You can even put up a banner containing photos of your developer that someone from this team did it. We'll look into this issue. We should make it feel gracefully. That should be a duty of us as front-end engineers. Okay, on the same lines, this is a very well-known practice. Everyone knows about it, that we should always put up our CSS and HTML up front, and then the JavaScript should load at last. Because the browser cannot do anything about your JavaScript code unless it has completely downloaded the JavaScript file. So we should not make any user wait for that, and then he'll end up blaming his internet or tweeting about your website. That's a bad omen. Okay, so am I going too quick or something? Too boring? No, right? Okay, so any questions till now on this?
Why not just load your JavaScript and header and basic code? That's what.
We can do that, but in my opinion, we should first display something to the user. Just push your index.html, load something. The user should be like, okay, my computer is able to connect to this website. This website will work fine, unless it's from a bad internet connection. So this makes up for user engagement, and people will come back to your product.
I think he's talking about the async tag that you add along with the script tag. So that doesn't really matter if you place it at the bottom or the top.
It does, but then we do not always serve our apps in a particular way. Sometimes we can be serving them using a platform like Adobe Experience Manager, and then let the platform handle all those things. So that's another situation. But the async tag is a good thing. We should definitely use it. And okay, fine. Let's move on. So I do not see many beginners here. So I think this, most of you should be familiar with everything that's written in this slide. Make the most out of native methods. So, reduce globals as much as you can. We all love using libraries. So sometimes we tend to overuse them, but that's fine. As long as you're managing your own globals in your particular code. So globals that are not placed in a good way can hamper your site's interaction with those libraries. We use a lot of libraries, like jQuery, Bootstrap, everything, or even Material.js for that. And yes, talking about the use of libraries, raw.js is always quicker. It executes always faster on the browser, no matter how old the browser is, how old the machine is, than a particular library. So sometimes your jQuery library may fail to load, but if you're good, if you've written raw.js, your code will always execute, even on the oldest of browsers, say IE6 or 5. Okay, so.
jQuery exists because of IE6, right? I mean,
yes.
Wouldn't there be any need of jQuery? If...
Yes.
So, your point is valid that raw is great, but then you have to kind of write a lot of if-elses and say if IE then do this, if Mozilla then do this, if Chrome then do this. So I guess it's a necessary evil. jQuery itself was a necessary evil.
Yes, yes, it is a necessary evil. I'm coming to that. So. We needed to put up a form to submit user data. Now, we do not care much about how we do our HTML design when we are developing sites for small companies, but when you are, when the user's money or any such heavy costly transactions are involved, we should be very careful about it. A bad placement of a single button inside a form can make the entire transaction go twice, which is a bad thing to happen, and you can end up in lawsuits again. So. That's a case of event bubbling that's spun up. We never expected it to happen because we were freshers, but it happened. And so the key takeaway from this entire thing is that we should always look forward to solve issues with design issues with HTML and CSS first, rather than directly jumping onto jQuery or JavaScript. We have the power in our hands, we can solve them. But a simple design change can make sure that the problem will never spin up again. So that's all. There are simpler ways to solve your problems. For example, the simple HTML attribute helps you to define the behavior of a button inside a form. Like if you assign type equals reset, then the entire form can reset itself. But type equals button is totally safe, and you can just attach a click event handler and do whatever you want, even if the button resides within a form. So tip, the primary role of JavaScript is to provide behavior to your website. We should stick to it. That was my key takeaway from this one. Things that help. Same thing again, use semicolons, because browsers can pass that for small scripts, but when you're writing a huge script, it will become a real pain for you to debug it in production stages. So use of semicolons, committing your code properly is very, very necessary. So eval is bad, eval function, because it allows you to access the JavaScript compiler, and you can possibly throw any string at it and get the result out of it. So this does not only create bad performance issues, it can also lead to huge security threats. So there's a line written here. You can read it, right? But didn't you wish that this was written in a darker color? Okay, so I laid it for you. A common error in JavaScript programs is to use an object when an array is required, or an array when an object is required. The rule is simple: when the property names are small sequential integers, you should use an array. Fine, but you no one can read it. Okay, so which brings me. To the main thing of this discussion, and that's, is your website accessible? So this is my forte. I have worked on accessibility for over a year. I worked for a bank, so you can rest assured, no matter what accessibility issues you have faced, we'll try to cover as many as possible. Why I'm taking this up? Because JavaScript events, if not handled properly, can really wreak havoc, and your code cannot be read by screen readers. Okay, let's talk something about web accessibility. Web accessibility is one of the most important things that you should consider in the design phase of your product. And this is a very basic thing that people usually look over. They do not give much importance to, because not every product has to serve the same kind of people. But whenever you're making any self-transactional portal or self-service portal, or say like an e-commerce portal, internet banking, all those stuff, you must and should take care of every single type of customer that will land up on your website. It's fairly important, but it is ridiculously boring to code for accessibility. I'll take that. So, like I said, JavaScript allows developers to do anything. They to add increase interaction, information processing, and control web-based content. Now, this is fine. This is, we all know that we can do that. But JavaScript can also introduce accessibility issues. So, consider that you cannot see, right? And you still have a bank account. Why not? You must have a bank account, okay? And then you land up on a banking website, and you say, okay, welcome to ABCD Bank. And when you press tab, it jumps onto the footer. That is a bad thing. You'll be lost somewhere. You do not know where to go. You'll try pressing shift tab. It goes somewhere else, which means you have not handled navigation properly, or something is there in your code which was maybe not designed properly or not scripted properly that is causing this issue. Now, these are very, very difficult to find. So what I'll suggest is always take these things up in the design phase, because it's really ridiculous to revisit them. And you'll end up writing code which will take down your application's performance and create more issues. So one bad fix for accessibility can lead up to 10 more fixes, bugs for that. So the main accessibility issues are navigation, hidden content, user control, and confusion or disorientation. The most important being navigation, and the most annoying being hidden content. Because sometimes you might not be aware, okay, how many of you used hidden anchor tags or buttons to trigger an event for a particular HTML element? We do that regularly, right? We do that. Now, that is good for us because we can code our requirements through it. We can code our way through and get the job done. But when a blind person lands on that thing, he'll be listening to the screen reader saying anchor tag for something. Now, that something is none of his concern. So those things cause great issues for accessibility. So let's move ahead. Within the context of your application, you need to decide how important web accessibility is for you. For instance, if you're developing, I said this already. So every customer is important. Let's have a look at first case study. So Jeff uses a screen reader software with synthesized voice that, and please mind that word, synthesized voice. That voice is already not clear. So whatever you are writing, that should be pretty clear, and then there are some practices that should go with it. Now, when you start off as freshers, or whenever you're in college, you're taught that, okay, always supply an alt text with an image tag. Always supply a title with a button. So these are the good things that we miss out, but we must and should put them. So he can find headings, click on links, read bank statements, but the pages must be carefully designed with screen readers in mind. And if there's too much information scattered throughout, it means basic headings like transfer money or make a payment get lost in the website's clutter. Now, this simple issue, although it sounds simple to us, this costed a bank $1.9 billion of fine. So simple issues like that can end up like causing huge losses. And it's not only a financial loss, it's a reputational damage as well. Because when you're running an organization that big, you have been like serving your customers for a lot many years, and if at any point in time the experience goes down, they'll not like it, because they are returning customers, they are old customers, they love you for your service. For instance, how important this is, it's illegal to have an inaccessible website in Norway, and that's not a good, that's a good news for all of us, because we'll be having by 2025 for all the front-end developers, I think you should keep this in your track. By 2025, a website that is not accessible will be of no use. So Canada is onto it, Norway has already done it, and India is getting stricter about it. So what makes your website more accessible? Cross-browser device testing. Different browsers might render your content in a different way. So we must and should go through a series of devices like an iPad and check for the orientation and everything. Whether VoiceOver is able to read everything in the horizontal mode or not. Or screen readers. Screen readers are the biggest aids. You must structure your header tags, paragraphs, and writer scripts in a way that screen reader softwares can do their job flawlessly without any hindrance. Now, why are the screen readers so important? You can say, okay, how many blind people are going to end up on my website? So, not many, but a statistic says that only 4% of people that visited websites who could access the World Wide Web, only 4% of them were able to fully use the World Wide Web. Rest of them had partial impairities. Now, partially impaired people are still your customers and we should serve them. And they can have multiple kind of issues with your website. They cannot even, they might not even recognize a particular color, and they might not be able to differentiate between the foreground and the background color, or say, okay, or they might not be able to navigate properly, right? So we must and should design our HTML, structure our HTML in such a way that we always have a headers in place. And I'll share this quick tip for designing websites with accessibility. So whenever you have a header in your page, the first thing that your screen reader should read is skip navigation header, so that your customers can directly jump onto the content. Now this is handled using JavaScript. And how do we do that? It's fairly easy, we all know about it. Site navigation. So your JavaScript code can create some real-time issues to your customers. So it's not always a JavaScript code, and it can be a bad structural design for HTML code. You might be missing accessible attributes like array label by role option. For example, if I'm blind or I'm partially impaired, I tab on a particular drop-down, I should be able to hear that, okay, this is a drop-down, select option one is this, select option two is this. And whenever you make a selection, you should be prompted, the user should be prompted that option one has been selected. Why am I coming back to screen readers again? Because screen readers for us are the user interfaces that we serve to a lot of customers. So it's not always JavaScript, it's not always HTML, CSS, or some fancy framework. A lot of times, it's the screen readers that is our front end. So the screen readers should be dealt very carefully with. And most of the screen readers, they behave in very different ways. For example, JAWS. So there are multiple screen reading tools like NVDA, JAWS, VoiceOver. VoiceOver comes with Apple. NVDA is free. JAWS, the licensing can cost you as much as an entire company. But still, that's the most used screen reading software. They're important. And okay, so if you have built a product already and it's into production, and then you're requested for a change, always do an impact assessment of that UI feature, that how your website's accessibility is going to get affected by that. It's fairly important, because a single bad placement of a particular element can wreak havoc with your site's navigation, and customers can get lost. Okay, the final point, build for everyone if you're building it for scale. You cannot ignore customers. You cannot just say, okay, chal raha hai na. That doesn't work. People feel bad when they're not served in the way that they expected them to be. In a nutshell, web accessibility is important. You can decide on levels of accessibility at which you want to code for. So web accessibility guidelines are put up on W3C, it's there. So you can choose for levels like A, AA, AAA. The best standard to go for is AA, because AA standards, like they take care of all the things that you need, and they're not an overkill like AAA standards. So AAA standards can keep your developers like writing code through nights. They are a real nightmare. So code for everyone. Consider every potential customer. Be careful with your JavaScript code. So be careful with how you handle your site's navigation or events. A single bad event fired can seriously cause some troublesome issues for your site navigation. So now we come down to this point. So JavaScript allows browser spoofing. That is a good thing to have, but we should not fall for it, because that will eventually lead us to write code specific to browsers. So that's why if there's an issue, it's in the level of your acceptance or your code structure. So always consider accessibility in your site's design phase. Thank you. I think how did it go?
What do you mean by design phase?
When you're trying to put up an architecture for your website, like what components is it going to be composed of, and for
is it a graphic designer or is it a developer?
It should be a joint responsibility of your UX person as the developer as well, because and your QA person as well, because the QA person is going to test it. The developer knows how the different things behave with their code, and obviously the UX designer should take care of color contrast and all those things and navigation.
You're saying the graphic designer should also give a web accessibility specification?
I think whenever he's putting up a particular color, so if he's putting up a particular text, he should always specify that, okay, for this text size, this should be my color contrast ratio. All those guidelines are available. So he should put up fonts in such a color that is readable to all. Like for example, if you're writing a simple blog, I've been a blogger for 5 years, so if you're writing a single blog, the most important thing is readability. So people suggest you to have small sentences, and subheadings and headings are a must. So also many times when you open a website on a screen reader, the screen reader can prompt you saying that proper header structure is not found. So the screen reader software will not be able to navigate it through. So that can create issues.
How do you see Indian bank?
They are fairly accessible. Even our income tax filing portal, when you open it, you can see, you can select font sizes, you can turn to accessible mode.
Oh, you like income tax site?
Yeah. Like they're fairly simple, but very, very good in transactions. Very fast.
Highly unprofessional.
Yeah.
Highly unprofessional.
Possible.
Especially for those who has come for the first time for the meetup. So this is our fifth meetup, okay? And we have covered a lot of topics, including Elasticsearch and microservices, etc. Okay. So again, coming back to landing cards. So my name is Mukesh, and I'm CTO here. And lending card, as most of you might be knowing, that is into SME lending. So we give loan to a small and medium enterprises. Okay. Many people may not know that lending card has like 100 plus number of people on the technology side. Okay. And I can bet that none of the banks in India will have that many tech people. Okay. They might have, say, IT team, etc. Okay. But certainly not the tech people. Okay. So we are fundamentally different than any of the NBFCs that exist in India, in that we are more of a tech company than basically a bank. Okay. If you simply contrast us with any banks, is that they work primarily in the branch model, etc. Okay. And LendingCart has no branches, and we don't even intend to have any branches. Okay. And we have grown from almost zero loan delivery to now, this year we are delivering 1800 crores, okay? And we are now we raised our Series C just few months back, close to $86 million, okay? So again, the idea here is that it should be the technology that should be basically used, number one, to get the customer on board, number two, do their credit evaluation, etc., okay? Number three, to deliver the loan, and then again assist in collecting as well, okay? So to give you some stats, so we are already there in more than now 1300 places in India, okay? So for any banks, etc., to reach 1300 places, so we are not talking about even tier 2 cities, okay? We are talking about really small towns, etc., okay? So it's almost impossible for anybody to reach those locations unless you are, say, for example, SBI, HDFC, etc. So for a tech company to come and reach, that's a milestone that we have achieved. So primarily because we are a completely digital lender. Okay, so people apply to us online. Okay, they provide us all their documents online. We do certain, say, parsing, etc. Okay, and our data science model runs on it, and it predicts things like whether the loan needs to be given to this individual or not. If yes, okay, then of course it has a different grading, like whether this customer is falling in A, B, C, D, E, F, okay. And based on that, it will predict like how much loan can be given to this individual, okay, what should be the tenure of that loan, and what should be the interest rate. Okay, so pretty much everything gets predicted, okay. And then after that, of course, there are certain things in the ecosystem, okay, that is preventing it to be completely touchless or humanless. For example, collecting their post-dated checks, etc. Okay, not all people have in like ENSH, etc. enabled. Okay. So that's where human touch is there. But as the ecosystem evolves, okay, so our vision is that it will be completely touchless, okay, experience for the customers. Okay, anyways, I will not take much time about lending card. Okay, so this is our fifth meetup. Okay, and we have covered a lot of topics. Okay, I just wanted to give you guys a glimpse of what lending card does. Okay, so take it over to Sid.
Hi guys, how it's going?
Quite boring.
Sorry. Yeah, kuch nahi hai. So I'm going to talk about few concepts of JavaScript. You might know about it, or you can say you might not know that well about it. So first I'm going to start with our old best friend, this, in JavaScript. So I hope all of you guys have encountered at least once a while a problem with using a this or something. So basically, to start with, you have to know that all functions in JavaScript have properties, just like an object. So, and each and every function also have a property known as this, which will only be assigned when the function is invoked on the context which the object invoked. Pretty much a definition, but I hope everybody get confused around it. So, we'll start with few of the concept where this is most misunderstood or becomes tricky. So before that we start, I want to give a brief about this, what is this. And so this always refers to a singular object. It cannot point out to multiple objects, and this is usually used inside a function or a method. You can use it in a global context, but if you have used a use strict mode, then it will be undefined. Or if you are using it in an anonymous function also, it will be undefined because it won't be bounded to any of the object. So currently there are actually four scenarios where this is basically misunderstood most. So when a function that uses it as a callback function. Second is when this is used inside a closure. I hope everybody understand what is closure. A closure is a function which can access the outer variable, outer functions variable, in a brief way. So, and third one is when we assign a method that use this to a variable. And the fourth one is when we borrow a method from any other object or any other functions. So, go to the first problem, basically. So, when a function that uses this is passed as a callback function. So as you can see, it's a very simple object is there. A user is an object and it has some data property. And there is a click handler function is there, which is using this to print the data's first name and age by concatenating it. So here what happens is, so as a developer, sometimes what happens is you might have used the click handler in JavaScript, jQuery, the last line. So you have a button click and you use your use click handler to print that name or age. But what happens is it will say that it cannot read the property 0 of undefined. So let me clear about it, like why this happens, then we go about the solution. So even though we are calling the click handler method with user.click click handler, the click handler method itself will execute it, but with the button context, not with the your user context, because the button itself gives an object. Once you access it, so dollar button, double quotes button is itself in the object. So always this will point to that instead of pointing to your user object. So coming to the solution part, how you can fix this? I hope you everybody have used bind. Everybody knows what bind does. It'll just bind the context of that object whichever you pass in its parameter. So here what we have to do is we have to pass hard codedly user.clickHandler.bind so that it knows that okay, this belongs to user object here. So the I hope you got like what was the issue, that this keywords no longer refers to the original object where the this was defined actually. And it was referring to the method that we invokes it. So it is one of the way where you might have encountered the problem. Like I have encountered this problem in my early careers. So the second one is when this is used inside a closure function. So it's important to take the note that closures cannot access the functions this variable. Although closures can access the outer variable of outer functions, but it cannot access the outer functions this variable, because every function will have its own this variable, right? So function itself cannot have that this. So here same you can see that I have written one show all function there which will print all the data which is present in the user data object. So inside that I'm using a for each which takes a callback function, and I'm using that item.name, and now I'm printing to one of the property which presents in the user object, not on the function which we are calling it. So that's why what happens is the output will come as the if name is John, so John undefined and Jane undefined will come like that. So coming to the solution part, how we can solve it is, so here is a same approach, but what we use is, and I hope this everybody have used it. So we are using the same function. Only thing what we did is here we have used as a user object. We have created one variable, this, and most of you have used it as a dat, where it was where that is equals to this. So and this is the way how the you say that block arrow functions work in basically ES5 or ES6 or ES7. So this is the way how we are solving it. So now we get the result as John 108 and Jane 108. So why this happens is because the show all context is preserved to user.object. So when you invoke the function user.showAll, so that the variable user.object will assign the value when once you invoke it. So this will not hold the value or where it will point until the function is invoked. Till that this doesn't have hold any values. So once you call it, so you know that okay, this is called as user.showAll, so the user object will hold that this and it will assign the value to it, and then you can access it inside a function. So third problem is when we assign a method that uses this to a variable. This is a generic problem I face actually a lot more times. So here's a user object, the same user object, John and Jane one. And we are using the same showAll function, which is printing just the name. But here, what I did was I created a variable and assigned it to a basically a variable. I use like that user.showAll function is assigned to a show user data, and this happens sometimes when you pass it also as a callback functions. So that also happens is when because the parameter is assigned to that function. So when you print it, it will say that cannot read the property for each of undefined. Because why? Because show user data is called on the window context, not in your user context here. So the function is copied, the function definition it have, but the this value is only assigned when you invoke the function. So here currently the this will not hold user context, it will hold the window context, and in window there is no data object, and if it is, if some data object is present, it will print that data object instead of printing of the user data object. So how do we solve it? Well, calling it, so we could have called, we could have solved it using bind also at the assigning level, but I preferred to use some different method apart from bind. So what I have used is I used call. So what call does it? It calls a function instead of just binding it. So what bind does it? It will bind the function, but it will not invoke it. But call will invoke it also. So you can pass the user object and it will be like assigned, it will take the context of the user. So show user data will take a concept of, then it will print John and Jane. So the fourth one, little tricky one, and still sometimes it happens with us. Sometimes when we borrow a method that uses this, so sometimes in some library we don't know, like the function is exists, but we try to borrow it or we try to use it in a different way. So sometimes it breaks. So why it breaks is, so we have here one variable is average score basically that have hold some string, and there is a function average is there which takes an array of scores and it gives out you the average. Basically it's set, instead of returning out the average score, what the function is, it sets the property dot average score. So we, what happens sometimes we think that it returns it, but it sets the property. So now I have one more game controller function, and where the score are some scores and average score is null. Now what I need is, I need the average score. So what I call with average dot game controller dot scores. And when I try to console.log it, only window.average score will hold 46.4 data. So currently change our variable which we have defined in a global scope. So this is also one of the problem when you try to use so much of global variables. So that's why we should avoid it using global variables, because anyone can change that variable. And but we don't get the value in the game controller's average score, although we called it in that by passing the exact arrays. Then how do we solve it? Again, we can solve it with the same our friend dot call function, and you can pass the parameter. Here I have used call instead of apply because I know the number of parameters. So when you know the number of parameters, you will use call, or else you will use apply. So console, now your average score will still be the global average score, and your game controller average score will be your whatever you wanted it to be. Any questions till this point? Anybody, any questions with this? I hope everybody got the clear concept of this and how this works, and when the this is got its value and all. So at last I'm going to tell that the biggest gotcha with JavaScript this is, I already told you that this is not assigned the value until the object invokes the function, right? Until it doesn't invoke, this will not hold the value. So this is the main concept which you have to remember it to solve any kind of this related problem. You might encounter some other problem apart from these four also. So you have to just have to remember that this will only get assigned the value where you called it, in which context, and after invocation only the this will hold the value. So coming to the second part, which is pretty much a very big topic, but I'll try to explain it as short as or as simple as possible. Prototypes, everybody got confused, and even I get confused a lot. So there are actually two concepts with prototype in JavaScript. So one is JavaScript function has prototype property. The second concept is the prototype in JavaScript is the prototype attribute, right? So this 2 points doesn't make that much clear, but at least we got to know that it's actually the two things, it's not the single thing. So the coming to the first point, JavaScript functions has prototype property, and you attach the properties and methods on the prototype properties. But when you will use this prototype properties, when you want to implement an inheritance, or when you want to inherit from a parent object or a parent constructor function. So this prototype is every object or every function have prototype properties. But I think everybody have used that object.keys or for in loop to loop through it. And you know why that prototype property doesn't come into the for loop? Because it's not enumerable. And have you guys ever encountered underscore underscore proto, the pseudo properties which Chrome or some versions of now Safari is also adding it, and Firefox also. But both the things are not same. Like prototype and underscore underscore proto is not same. Underscore underscore proto is just the methodology to access prototype properties. It's just a simple way to access the properties. It's not, both are not same. Second part is, so objects prototype attribute points. So whenever you want to, second point, an object's prototype attribute points to prototype attributes is normally referred as a prototype object. Who all understands this? Prototype attribute is normally referred as prototype object. What is prototype object? Anybody? Anyone?
You can attach a new functionality to any of the standard library objects.
Okay. Why? Because it's an object. So I just wanted to know one thing, just like it will make everything clear. So when the prototype object get attached to an object, once you create an object, with number of methods are there to create an object. Object literals are there, object.create is there, the new object is also there. So when that prototype object actually get attached to an object, constructor methods are also there, like apart from that. So when it is going to attach it, whenever you create an instance of that, you have created a constructor, you have created, once you create an instance, it will attach a prototype property. So just a tricky question, anybody knows, like everything have its prototype, right? So just wanted to ask one thing, there are primitive data types and there are complex data types. So primitive data types are string, number and boolean and all. So how are you able to access string dot to split or string dot join or like array dot join or something? Yeah. Anyone? Because prototype methods are there, but string is a primitive data type. And new capital S string is an object, which is a built in object.
So it's because of there is a prototype chain. So object string is referring to object as a parent.
So just now in the first point I cleared it. Prototype can only exist in an object, not in a primitive data type, correct? So currently, I'll tell you, so what happens is, there is a coercion between the string and the new string, the whatever the string object is there. So our compilers know that, okay, here we created, so he coerces it. So it's trying to manipulate it based on that. So it borrows the function and applies it on the runtime. Not, it doesn't have actually that prototype property. So primitive, so if anybody says you that JavaScript is all objects, it's wrong. They have primitive data types, and those primitive data types only coerce on that, they are built-in object types.
So, does it have any performance issues? Should I create objects and then do it so that the compiler doesn't have to do,
so,
or is it fine?
So, one thing which I want to say, if you don't want to use any prototype or any, if you're just storing your data in an object format just to iterate it over a for loop or something, do not have its prototype at all, because you don't need that much functionalities, right? You need a simple object. So try to create it with a null prototype if you don't use it. So that might give you some performance leverage there. The most important part, why is prototype important and when it is used? So everybody has used prototype chaining. And some might have, let me clear it. Prototype is important in JavaScript because JavaScript does not have a classical inheritance based on classes. So in other languages, we have classes, we extend it, and we create an inheritance. Even though in TypeScript and ES6, we have classes in extend, but internally it uses prototype once it's compiled by Babel or like whatever transpiler you are using. And therefore, all the inheritance which is possible is we are doing it via prototype only. And that is, I already explained to you the prototype attribute, accessing the prototypes on its objects. So once you have added the inheritance, how do you access it? So in other languages, you can that object holds those values in its own memories and all, so it can point directly. But here it holds in its prototype. So what happens is it first searches it inside that object's property, and after that it goes for its prototype, and after that it goes for the prototype. So that is prototype chaining. So there is a parent, then child, then subchild, then subchild, then subchild. So it goes into that way.
Is there a copy of the parent prototype or more than one?
So basically the it will not be a copy of it. It's just a prototype points to that object. So prototype can also tell you that it's from which parent it came from.
For memory, like application that wants to save memory, this.
So that that part will come to how do we solve what all the problems we face with the inheritance with when we use like prototype inheritance and all, and how could we solve it? How should we have done it? So this is a simple example of prototype chaining. Just wanted to explain for the guys like might new to JavaScript or haven't any idea on a prototype. So you create one constructor function which holds one value, and you create one other functions which hold other value. What you do is you assign dot prototype to its own object. And if you want to like subtype dot prototype, if you create that super type dot prototype, so it will hold its own, its parent's prototype object instead of holding the new super type object. So I think everybody's clear around this, or I have to go deep and explain this anywhere. This is the way inheritance is done in plain JavaScript, vanilla JavaScript. No. Can change the
colors.
Color. Accessibility issues. But how to increase the font size?
No, it's a screenshot.
No, this is not the screenshot. This is a text.
Just change the background color to white. The background can be green.
Change karna padega. Slide me. Okay, we'll. Yeah, we'll do for the next time.
It's
okay.
Background
change kar dena. Make background
white. Yeah, now try to change the content of the
font.
Completely
black.
Yeah.
Very good.
ठीक
है बेटर विजिबिलिटी आई जस्ट मेड इट लुक लाइक दैट बिकॉज एवरीबडी इज फेमिलियर टू दैट सिंटेक्स ऑफ मोनोकाई. फॉन्ट साइज थोड़ा इंक्रीज करूंगा तो बाहर चला जाएगा. Or is it clear?
Yeah.
So before the prototype got assigned, both subtype and supertype had object in the prototype.
So currently what we are making is here. So this is the parent. So we are trying to create this is the child and this is the parent. So child is inheriting from the parent. Usually what happens in class level inheritance also, child always inherits the, but it can actually work for other way around also, but in JavaScript specifically. Everybody clear with prototypes? Little bit clear about prototype, how can we do inheritance? Or there are actually n number of other methodology also to do inheritance. Just wanted to focus. This is the simplest example of prototype inheritance which I can try to create.
So this will return the subtype CHS.
What? Not able to
create. This will return the subtype CHS.
That will return a subtype's age, yeah. It will actually, a subtype object, so once you create, after the inheritance is done, so inheritance is done between the class, so after that when you create an object, so that object holds the parent class of property also and the child class property also. Just, it's a simple example of inheritance. I'm just trying to explain you why, like inheritance, so that we can...
You said it's just reference to the parent.
Right?
Is the property the classical inheritance?
It's just a reference also. It's not. So the name property will not be inside the subtype constructor. It will be there in the supertype constructor only. So basically what happens is when you call new, right, it calls your constructor function also. That's what not happens when you create an object with object.create. It will not call your constructor. So once you create an object with new, it always call your constructor also. So you'll have all the properties. Should I move?
Can I potentially use this for sharing data between different objects? Create an object and create five objects, all of them, use some same object as prototype.
So basically inheritance is always helpful in reducing
the inheritance, it's data sharing. Is that
data sharing can be done via inheritance, but still, like, I know the problems from inheritance, that's why I have not coming to that point. So let's moving on. Problems with prototype inheritance or any inheritance which we have done previously in our... So there is a tight coupling between base, parent class, child class, it will all be tightly coupled. So even if you add, if you have to add sibling around it, you have to go around it. So there will always be coupling. You cannot mix and match and use it, whatever you need, right? And fragile base class problem is basically the problem of JavaScript. So you can always, basically you can set null to a null to a base class, and then all your objects will stop working, right? So that is a problem when your base class is a fragile. Anybody can change any property, they can do anything around it. And then if it is a fragile base class problem, inflexibility occurs. There is no flexibility. So basically what is happening is you need some new properties. Again, you have to create one more constructor function. Even if you have to create one property, one new property, which all should hold or which some should hold. And you have to give it to all kind of thing. And duplication by necessity becomes a problem. So sometimes you have to duplicate your code. Let's say you have one object, animal is there, and one object, aquatic animal is there. Now you got amphibian, which can do both. So what do you have to do? You have to add both the properties into the boat, or it will extend from both. So it will have all the properties. And some properties of normal land animals or aquatic animal, amphibian doesn't need also, but you'll get it. So that is what our fifth problem is. Fifth problem is gorilla and banana problem. I hope everybody have heard of you. So what you needed was a banana, but what you got was a gorilla holding a banana and with the entire jungle, right? So you need one property inside that object, but you got whole lot of property due to your prototype inheritance. So it holds and it creates some issues. So this is simple problems. This is a simple problem statement. This is our ES6 class creation. Looks like we created a guitar. Font color change, sorry.
Oh,
problem is we are kind of more into development, haven't used PPT and all that much. So I'll quickly explain you what is it here. So bass amp inherits from the guitar amp and channel script inherits from bass amp and guitar amp. I got some example of class, don't wanted to create my own class and all. This is an example how object oriented design actually goes wrong. So channel strip isn't actually need the guitar amp and doesn't actually need the cabinet at all. So channel strip object, once you try to create channel strip object, it doesn't need the cabinet property, because it will not never have the cabinet. So better option would be to create a new base class. The both amps and channel strip inherit from, but again you will having end up duplicate codes. And eventually, or else you can create one shared class. But that is also eventually breaks when it goes into a long run. How many shared class you will create, or how many base classes you will create. So the better way of, instead of using inheritance, which is there in actually JavaScript, but we are trying to copy other languages and trying to move on to that. So I'll say that use function composition or object composition. You guys might heard of this. What happening is we created, for each property we created one object, and what object.assign, everybody assign, everybody knows what object.assign does. It creates actually a new object. So here that the first parameter is your object in which those properties are assigned. So here what you can do is, so basically instead of creating all those classes, so here guitar amp is there, so we need distortion, volume, cabinet and option, so we got that, we don't need anything else. We have bass amp, we got those things. So object composition basically works what you want to do, not what are those elements. So inheritance and everything around works around the physical world, that what it is, like animal, what it is. It, dog is an animal, so it should belong to a dog animal class and all. So inheritance works in that way. But composition works like what properties that dog should have. So it's now up to you guys, like judge when to use composition or when to use inheritance. Majors, all the JavaScript framework uses inheritance, so I cannot outrun those. But still I would prefer that you should go for object composition, because it's much easier and much faster and much more flexibility is for all you guys. And you can see that, right? We don't need whatever properties we don't need, we don't give it to it. Why to have all those properties all together?
So why did you make them as constants?
Because it's non-changeable. Like I don't want guitar amp to be an A again initialized at something else. So once you use a const keyword, so if I again try to initialize or try to assign something to guitar amp, it will throw me a compilation error. I'll not say the error will after, like at compilation stage only it will show the error, because
but
JavaScript is not
volume and all, they so can be changed, right?
They no, so volume is actually a volume holds the object which holds a volume property. Volume property can be changed. I don't want to create one more instance of volume property. Volume property can be changed.
Or can be shared
across. So basically once you use this, so volume property will have, like channel strip will have its own volume property.
Volume.
Or every instance of it will have its own volume property.
Volume dot volume.
Volume dot volume basically. So volume is changeable totally.
Means, you know, in this approach actually the way you assign properties are different than inheritance approach.
Yeah, inheritance you get everything, right?
You
don't need some things, right? Let's say dog has four legs, right? But fish has no legs, but you get that legs also, right? If you assign those properties into animals. So that is the problem with inheritance. So inheritance is something like which we talk, like I inherited my surname from my father inherited from somewhere, so it works with like that. So, or you can say that I'm a man and I'm a human, so I belong to human class. But I can say that I have two arms. It cannot happen for every human or everything, right? So that's what happens. Any questions? Done. I don't have any.
Is rights available on that?
Table.
Huh?
So,
that we make sure, yeah.
When you're using object.assign, so then source object will also inherit the prototype property of that thing?
The source object will also inherit the prototype property of those distortion and value. Yes. That it will inherit. So it will only hold the main our new capital O objects properties, which we might need, and we actually doesn't know who is creating an instance, and they might need some property out of it, like has own property, or you can say dot to string, so they might need it. So those properties, I still want it should be there, because we don't know like how they are going to use it, right? Those getter setter properties and is prototype of, or some properties are there, which is sometimes a user or developer will use it. That's why I want it to be there. Or you can remove that also with object.create. Object.create you pass, and you can use null and create those objects and add the properties. But object.create, if you really don't want. So if you really don't want any prototype for a distortion object, what you can do is you can use object.create null, and after that, in second parameter, you can add distortion as well. So you'll not have any other properties apart from your properties. That is for sure. You will only have those properties. Even if you try to access other properties or dot prototype also, you will not able to access it.
Isn't that same as just saying distortion is this object or this dictionary?
It's just an object.
Yeah, I'm saying, rather than saying object.create null and then passing this object, to create an object that doesn't have any legs, if I can use that word, why don't you just use this object, like the curly braces, that's an object without any such property,
but he said that it will have its prototype property, which got inherited from the capital O object, which is basically the
dot create. You are essentially removing the proto property.
Yeah, I am removing everything around it. It should hold only what I said. So if you really want it, but I not suggest it. Get the point.
So, way it works is it copies all the property of distortion into the first object, then it copies all the things of volume into first object, right?
Yes.
So, can't you do that in the last object? You can just say prototype here.
So, but it will then object will point to the same property, right? Which I don't want.
Okay.
Because volume can hold different values. So, if you pass the prototype, it will hold, it will. The properties will be with the prototype only. It will not be with the my new objects. Right? So if we change, that will change. Right?
Okay.
I hope I got your question correct, or something I might missed. Can you like, if you want something, you can ask. Yeah, so what you said is why don't I just pass the volume.prototype to this object, right? Object.assign. Okay.
When you are passing an empty object, then
okay.
Distortion, then volume, right?
Yeah.
I asked you, what if you just pass as a last object, as the last argument to this object.assign? And object which only contains prototype, which is equal to null.
Object which only contains object.prototype equals to null.
Yeah.
So it will not copy anything, right? You are actually passing. Or it will
hold
this.
Prototype of final object will basically.
So basically, you are trying to say like instead of creating other four objects, I should create one object, correct?
No.
Okay.
So this syntax would be an equivalent of doing object dot create null. You can also do this where you
okay.
Pass prototype null and.
Acha, null in the third parameter.
Yeah.
You are trying third parameter, right?
There
are multiple parameters.
Yeah.
Okay. So you are saying that, oh, okay. Null as a, I'm not sure about it. It will have a object.prototype values or not. Because one object is null, but other objects will have that properties. So it will again copy it, right? Overrides the previous values. Okay, so you are trying, you are chopped. Here only we can do that object.create.null, you are saying. Okay. That is also one way to do it. But still I would suggest that hold prototype property. It have some properties which might be useful in the later case. Any questions? Thank you guys.